Hey, first thing I want to give is a shout out to our staff out there. And on your chairs, you'll see an orange sheet, and we're going to hand out. And the sheet is to join an AGR. You get a free hat today if you do so, and you're also entered to win an AR-15. We're also making a quick off-the-cuff announcement that anybody who joins here this weekend will also get a free PMAG, an AR-15 mag shipped to them. So if you own an AR-15 or ever want one, we have lots of them. We'll be happy to send you one. So that's with a membership today. And so use that orange form and you can join at the booth. I need to recognize one of our new LPAC attendees. His first time ever is Joe Neville back there. He's in the very back there. Joe's works out of our Colorado office, and he'll be working now with Chris Cooper on our federal program. You may not know his face, but you do know his work. If you followed in 2013 when three state senators in Colorado were recalled, that was Joe's work. Yeah. Joe led those efforts and was the day-to-day operator and advocate for us. Joe is one of those guys that has a very stiff spine. You kind of need that when you're working in a state capitol, especially when you use the strategies we use and in the midst of gun control debates. In fact, Joe's also known for being kicked out of the Colorado state capitol. Yeah, he was literally talking to a state representative. She was mad because we had mailed in her district, knowing that she was a weak-kneed vote on the gun issue, and screamed and yelled and asked the State Patrol to kick him out, because his response to her when she said that, whining about the mail, he says, "You just bought yourself another round of mail." So, yeah. In some working environments, you might get a demotion, maybe even termination for that kind of activity. In our office, you get rewarded with a handgun and a promotion. So, yeah. In fact, our political affairs team often brags about, you know, "Hey, today I was just yelled at by a state senator," and the other one, you know, another person in the office will say, "Oh, that's nothing. Yesterday it was a congressman." So, yeah, it's kind of fun. I would like to, just so I know my crowd here, ask who in the room owns a firearm? Let's just say one. Just raise your hand, okay? Who in the room owns, let's say, quite a number of firearms? Yeah, yeah. Okay. Who in the room can arm a third world country? Yeah, yeah. You like to know your audience. That's not really what I'm here to speak about, although I do love to talk about firearms themselves. What I want to talk about is kind of debunking these myths and objections that the left uses about firearms and self-defense. And as you can probably guess, you know, every time there's a tragedy and they offer gun control as the solution, it's always a very reasoned and open-minded debate with facts and everything that ensues in the state legislatures and in Congress, isn't it? Well, if on the off chance that you actually do come into a reasoned and open-minded and civil debate, I want to give you some items and ways to answer that. Number one might be, let's use their argument, that you're more likely to be hurt by your own weapon. That's a real interesting concept, and they try and use it as a statistics. It's really from an interview where they had used some very scurrilous methods to come up with these numbers, but they essentially found where someone had been shot in an incident, and then they go into the household and ask, "Do you own a firearm? Is there a firearm present in this household?" And then they add that in the statistics if there was a firearm there. It doesn't mean that firearm actually shot the person that was hurt. It literally was, it was just there. And they count that number. When in fact, of the study that they used, if you get down into the numbers, of the 444 deaths in this one study, only 8 were from, the deaths were caused by that particular firearm they cited. And in most cases, it was used by a firearm on the outside. Really, that is, if you look at the numbers, only about 1 out of 1,000 times that a firearm is used for self-defense is someone actually physically killed. Most cases, it's brandishing the weapon. It's the mere presence of the weapon, or the assailant understands that the weapon is there, or you're a household owner and the burglar realizes someone's there, and of course they have a firearm with them. There are many ways in which firearms are used with the firearms not discharged or frankly, not even displayed. So they like to use that concept that, oh, firearms there is a real, automatically means you're going to be hurt by your own firearm. That's silly. Number two, other countries have lower gun violence rates. Now, Professor John Lott had debunked a lot of that, and in fact, he's done full studies of countries, and when you get down to the real statistics, the higher the gun ownership, it's actually a lower crime rate in almost every single case. Now, you all know that the United Kingdom banned firearms about 2 decades ago, the essentially defensive firearms. You can still get a hunting weapon, but it's very difficult, and defensive weapons, especially handguns, are completely banned, and even law enforcement doesn't have those except in rare cases. Well, when they did that, immediately, the number of hot burglaries in that country went up dramatically. What's a hot burglary? That's a case where the burglar knows someone's home, but they don't care. Are you going into a house? Why would you care if someone's home? They don't have a gun. They have no way to defend themselves, all right? Number three, that firearms and the concept of the right to keep and bear arms are really meant for hunting or sporting purposes. And that's made its way into federal law, even Jorge number one, you all remember George Bush, he actually bought this concept, and as did his son, and many other Republican politicians have done so as well. But if you really think about it, sporting purposes, where do we get to the point where the Bill of Rights applies to sporting? So let's apply that to the idea of sports or sporting purposes. So in other words, the First Amendment only really applies if you're arguing with your friends about football. Does that make any sense? Of course not. It makes no sense. Or, like the Third Amendment, we're all very worried about quartering in our house and being forced to quarter NBA players. Well, clearly we're not, but it's the same argument that they make for the sporting purposes, or that you need a speedy and public trial for video replays in hockey or football. You know, that clearly that's not what we were talking about. Number four, founding fathers didn't foresee these kind of weapons. Boy, I hear that a lot. They didn't know that there would be semi-automatic firearms. Do we think they were like Luddites that literally thought that the level of firearms at the time that they wrote the Bill of Rights was just static and would stay there forever? Well, of course not. It's been changing and continue to change. In fact, in the late 18th century, it was changing rapidly. We'd just moved from wheel locks and match locks into flint locks, and we're moving into rifled barrels. In fact, the Brown Bess, if that was the most common firearm during the Revolution, and it was known for rapid reloading. It was actually had a bore, it was a smooth bore, and it had a wider bore than the actual bullet so that it would draw, you could load it quickly instead of having to sit and ramrod in a rifle barrel. So they actually knew quite good and well what the firearms advances would look like. But really, if you think about technology changing, what about the First Amendment again? Does that mean that only old printing presses, Gutenberg presses, are actually covered by the First Amendment? Well, of course not. What about, you know, the internet or TV. I mean, I'm sure everybody here, we all know that we don't want to live in a world without Rachel Maddow and Mike Huckabee and Mike Hucksterby is what we call him, and Bill O'Reilly on 24-hour news station. Come to think of it, that's a bad analogy, really. We'd kind of be nice to live without those three on TV. But really, clearly the television is covered, even when they're saying distasteful things. It's covered by the First Amendment. So, number five, that the Second Amendment was about state militias. Well, if that's the case, then why did all these states, 44 states, include a provision for the right to keep and bear arms within their state constitutions? In fact, Vermont's reads that the people have a right to bear arms for the defense of themselves in the state. Maine says every citizen has a right to keep and bear arms for the common defense, and this right shall never be questioned. Sounds good, man. I like that one. Yeah. New Hampshire says all persons have the right to keep and bear arms in defense of themselves, their families, their property, and the state. That's pretty good. Colorado, I know that one by heart, of the right of no person to keep and bear arms shall be called in question. Now, it says not call into question. Well, gun control, isn't that what gun control is, immediately calling into question the right to keep and bear arms? Of course it is. And if they're being honest with themselves, they would say, yes, it is. They want to somehow tie it to the militia, but you can see from all those state constitutions, they're not tying it to any militia. Now, of course, we all know that the militia definition includes all the men in this room, but you can even ignore that argument when you're talking to somebody and say, nah, let's not talk about the militia because it's been labeled as somehow nefarious as Timothy McVeigh types. We just talk about the fact that it was given to individuals. And of course, one of their other arguments is that it only limits the local government or federal government and not states. Well, we fixed that with the McDonald case. In fact, I was quoted by Chief Justice Alito in that majority opinion where it was ruled that is incorporated directly to the states. In other words, the restriction in the Second Amendment applies to your state. It has to. And that was really a clarification of the Heller decision. I wish I could say that was all solved. I think we know it's not solved yet. Number seven, that the Second Amendment is limited. That somehow you can't, it's a limited right. It's not unlimited. You can't yell fire in a crowded theater. But where does that analogy break down? Gun control is like having sergeant-at-arms, government agents, at the doorways to all these entrances of this room, and them duct taping your mouths before you walk in the door because you might yell fire in the crowded theater. It's prejudicial. You've already decided they might say something, and therefore we'll restrict them. And we'll have a government agent walk through it and listen to what you were going to say, the question you were going to ask beforehand, my speech notes, anything to that effect long before you actually give it. Well, I think we can all see that has kind of a minority report feel to it, where it's looking in the future and somehow we're going to predict what someone's going to say. Now, if you followed any of the last 20 years of debates on concealed carry, you'll hear their siren cry of the left in response to trying to expand the use of self-defense is there will be blood in the streets. Literally, they must go to a class, and they're taught this over and over again because they use it all around the country over and over and over again. Every time we talk about any firearms expanding their rights or repealing or opposing their gun controls, they say there will be blood in the streets. Now, in the United States now, about estimates are that there are 11 to 12 million people carrying firearms on a daily basis for self-defense, and those are citizens, not including any law enforcement. 11 to 12 million people at any given time. And given the rapid expansion of that ability in many states, to use handguns for self-defense, both open carry and concealed carry, you got to think, if they really think there's going to be blood on the streets, they better get the public works guys working on a new trench or gutter for all the blood that's going to happen. Because, of course, it's going to be gore in every street. Well, did that happen anywhere? In fact, all the statistics show that Vermont is the safest state in the nation. And that Vermont has an absence of any restriction on carrying concealed. Just carry. If you can legally own a gun, you carry. In fact, they didn't actually even put a restriction in their constitution or their state statutes, which is nice. Now, we've gained that in other states, in Alaska, we've gained it in Arizona, where Senator Ward here is from, we gained it in Wyoming in 2011, where I think we mailed one of every 10 households in the state of Wyoming three times to muscle the politicians there into voting for constitutional carry, and got it.
And
no, yeah, there's no blood in Arizona, not like that, and certainly not for that reason. Maybe poor border security, but the fact is, it's expanding on a daily basis, and we don't see those problems. And sometimes even the legislators who debated that, the far left, will admit, I was wrong. And we saw that just recently when the New York Times admitted we were wrong about assault weapons. They really aren't used in crimes. They literally just said that. So one area that, number nine, that that I think that would is interesting argument is that firearms regulation and controls will help the disadvantaged somehow. Now, what you're doing is making it vastly more expensive to go through the process of getting a firearm and acquiring a firearm for self-defense. Here in Washington, D.C., if you can even get through the process, you're literally looking at $500 to $700 of government red tape and regulation. That's not including the price of the firearm or the training that you should go through when you get one. Yet, they claim that somehow that's going to help the poor and disadvantaged. It really kind of set up an interesting nexus with government regulations in inner cities and to the poor and disadvantaged, especially in those rough areas where you frankly need a firearm for self-defense. And now they put these people in this weird spot where only government's in charge of self-defense. Well, law enforcement admits, at least those being frank with us, that they are really forensic historians. They are there to draw a line around your body and to take the report and to go back and file it later and put the paperwork in. They are not there to defend you. It's your own job. You have to defend yourself with your brain, sometimes with your feet by running, and of course, if need be, with a firearm. Number 11 is kind of a favorite of mine because creating gun-free zones is somehow making people safer. Just recently, my library in my town that my wife and kids, who are sitting right over here, go to frequently, they were at the library, and one of our friends, somebody who works for us, was kicked out because she had a firearm on her. And so what we did was, we went immediately to the board of the library and said, your law doesn't apply. State law overrides that. And they argued it a little bit and then said, we'll deal with this in a month at our next board meeting. And we said, okay, well, we'll fix that sign right now for you. And we just literally put this up on their no gun sign that basically says, state law says I can have guns. They're permitted there. Well, what were they going to do? Say, you helped us out? That's wrong of you. I mean, we were saving the taxpayers money by fixing their sign without even hiring anybody. It's obviously ludicrous to think that people are safer because there's a government piece of paper there that says you can't have a gun. Only people who are going to follow that are law-abiding citizens. And in fact, Colonel Jeff Cooper summed it up very clearly. He said the only proper answer to unwarranted force is swift, overwhelming counterforce. And I hope you will join with us not only in trying to change America in that respect, and convincing them that they need to take their own defense seriously, but I hope you'll join with us as an organization in convincing the politicians of the corollary, which is, if you go against these citizens, we will kick you out of office. That's our job. Thank you very much.